So there are my slides. So welcome everyone.
You can get going, yeah.
Yes, excellent. So I'm actually giving this talk today from within our reverberation chamber. So I can't see my video at the moment. There it is. So if I try to zoom out with my camera, then you can already see the large mode stirrer in the background and some field probe behind me. And because we had some, I would like to do actually some virtual lab tour, but we had some during the test, some issues with the audio. So I will postpone it towards the end, start with my presentation first, and then at the end, even if we might have some problems with the audio, I would like to do some short laboratory tour here inside our reverberation chamber in Magdeburg. So let me try to zoom once again in with my camera. It does not work. Okay. So let's start with some overview over the other test environments that you typically use for EMC tests. The maybe most simple and most not common one, but simplest one is some open area test site. You just take two antennas and put your EUT somewhere in an open space and measure coupling between the EUT and the antenna. Maybe take care that the ground has a nice conductivity. Okay, now camera zooming. So then you have, of course, maybe some issues with the weather. In the winter, it's very cold and so on and so on. So you can nicely try to replicate this in a semi-anechoic chamber. So we have also a semi-anechoic chamber in Magdeburg with a 10 meter measurement distance. So we can do measurements starting from 30 megahertz. And this is more or less the same as an open area test site, just inside some laboratory. So you have these absorbers on the walls so that there are no reflections from the walls. Still, there is metal behind these absorbers for sure, because you want to have some Faraday cage. You want to shield yourself in this laboratory from the surrounding, to only measure the emissions that really come from your own devices under test. And if you do immunity testing there, also you want to potentially disturb only the devices under test there and not half of the city in the surrounding. Then there are also fully anechoic rooms. This is a picture here from Ghent University. Of course, it's not so easy to walk inside these fully anechoic rooms. They are typically used for antenna measurements, also for EMC measurements above 1 gigahertz. And then there are these TEM cells, GTEM cells. We also have a large one in Magdeburg. And the common thing of all these other test environments here is that they somehow measure in a directive way. So you put your EUT and then in a certain direction, in a certain distance, for the GTEM, the distance is to be discussed, but in a certain direction, you measure what something radiates, and you can also radiate onto something from a certain direction for some immunity test. And so then, a reverberation chamber is something somehow completely different. And some nice quote about reverb chambers is from Carl Baum. He unfortunately, as you can see, passed away some years ago. And he had kind of funny paper, the microwave memo number 3, which is called the microwave oven theorem, all power to the chicken. We will come back to this all power to the chicken towards the end. And there he asked this question: what is the difference between a microwave oven and a reverb chamber or mode stirrer chamber? And says, okay, the former cooks chicken and the later cooks electronics. So as I'm now sitting in the reverberation chamber or inside the mode stirrer chamber, it's a little bit like I'm also sitting in a very large microwave oven, not really being cooked, but okay. Maybe also tested for some reason, but the field generator, signal generator is not turned on yet. I will turn it on later for some experiment. Okay, so after this short motivation, some short look onto the agenda, I will try to give you some brief overview over reverberation chambers. Then we take a brief look onto some theoretical fundamentals. Then, of course, I would like to talk about the normalized or normative standardized measurements. So for the validation of such chamber and for immunity and emission tests. And towards the end, we will come to some comparison with other test environments. And there's someone still, I think, Mike, maybe you could mute your microphone. There's some disturbance from there. Would be really appreciated. So the setup, and as said, I will give some, try to give some virtual lecture towards the end, is you have a shield room. So you have metal all around. Because you want to shield yourself from the environment, you only want to measure emissions from your device on a test. You only want to, during an immunity test, test the device on a test inside the chamber. So you need to somehow shield yourself from the environment. And of course, you need antennas to generate the field, transmitting antennas and receiving antennas to measure some field. You might have your device on a test somewhere. And then if you excite the field in here with some antenna, very simple model would be that the antenna generates a wave, a plane wave, and the wave hits the wall and gets reflected and hits maybe this wall and gets reflected and hits another wall. And so you have traveling waves going back and forth inside this chamber. And now these back and forth traveling waves are superposed. So what you get is standing waves. So you get a standing wave pattern, which we will see in a moment. And so now the during some immunity tests, for example, the test result would strongly depend on where you put your device on a test. Is it in a position where there's a high field strength, where there's some antinode of the standing wave pattern, or is it inside some position where there's some antinode, where the field is more or less zero? So you would, during some immunity test, inside just a shielded room, you would need to move your device on a test around. You would need to carry it around or move it through space so that it sees a high field strength and low field strength. And of course, you do not want to do this. So there is this saying, if the prophet cannot go to the mountain needs to go to the prophet. So if we use this idea for reverb chambers, the idea is we do leave our device on a test in space, but we move the field around. And moving the field around works with a device that changes the reflection of these waves, waves traveling back and forth, or changing the electromagnetic boundary conditions of this cavity resonator that we have built. And as these standing waves are called modes, and because we use this to change the modes, to steer the modes, it's called the mode steerer, and the whole environment then there is called mode steerer chamber. And that's essentially the idea. So if we would take a look at this changing field pattern at the standing wave pattern, this is approximately what you would also get in your microwave oven at home. If you would have dimensions of 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter, and the wavelengths and the frequency inside the microwave oven at home is 2.4 gigahertz, which corresponds to a wavelength of 12 centimeters. So you would have five half wavelengths in the one direction and five half wavelengths in the other direction. And then you can see that the points where it's blue and red, these are these antinodes. There would be a very high field strength there. And all these green lines or greenish lines, these are the nodes of this standing wave where the field strength is very small. And so in your microwave oven at home, there's typically this turntable and you move the food or the water or whatever you want to heat up through this field so that it's the field pattern is somehow randomized, or it sees sometimes a high field strength and small field strengths and gets evenly warm. And in reverb chamber, we would move these nodes and antinodes through space by rotating the mode steerer. That's more or less the idea of a reverberation chamber. Okay, so now the question is, how can we move the field around? How can we change this field pattern? And I have a task for you, because I want to have it a little interactive. And I have checked, you should, above my screen share, there should be something that looks like a drawing tool. And if you click on this, you can ask the meeting host, maybe Ram, who has to say, okay, you can draw, please try this and please try. So this is, I've prepared, okay. And I have to, I think I have to say yes. And there are more and more questions coming in. So the line that I've already drawn, this should be the axis around which the stirrer rotates. And please think of some nice stirrer design and draw a good stirrer design. Maybe I've spoiled, of course, a little bit, because you can see our stirrer here behind me. And there's still some more people asking. Okay, so we see some proposals. And the first one is, and the third one is the classical Z-fold stirrer that you could also see behind me. And the advantage of this one, let's say, is that it's a fairly simple mechanical design, and you can build it rather large, and it's asymmetric. So if I add something here to this first sketch, which is very good, yeah, so if you would rotate this around and rotate it by 180 degree, then it would look like this. So it would look somehow exactly opposite. And then it really, really changes the field pattern. I will show you our stirrer design that we had before here. And this was some old design. It was not very efficient. Okay, I will give you some more time to draw something. I really like this. I think what is key for a good stirrer design is it must be large, there must be a huge diameter, and it really must be asymmetric. The closer the shape is to a cylinder, nothing will happen, because if you rotate the cylinder, it will not change the field. And so this with some plates here in this lower left corner. During the lab tour, later on, I will show you something. We have a small stirrer here, some additional stirrer that can rotate a little faster that we used for some recent measurements. This also works quite nicely, as long as, once again, there is some asymmetry there. Okay, excellent. Let me see if I can save this. And then I need to find out how I can delete this. So thanks for this. Excellent. This is really appreciated. I think the easiest way is, and this also,
you want to take the questions in between or at the end?
Yeah, we can have questions in between. Yes. If there's a question now, I would be happy to answer this question.
Okay, Paul, then go ahead and ask the question. Unmute yourself.
Okay, I cannot hear something.
Yeah, even I don't hear it. I think actually we'll put it to the end, otherwise it's going to disturb you.
Sorry, I didn't mean to raise my hand. Okay. Yeah. No problem. Okay, so good stereo design. I will show you a bad stereo design later on, but I think all your proposals were quite good. Okay, so pros and cons of reverb chambers. Because of this high quality factor, you get a very high, or you can get quite high field strengths with low input power. Then you save money and costs on large power amplifiers. And because of these statistical uniform fields that you get quite robust tests. It does not matter, we will see later on, it does not matter where you place your device on test. The direction does not matter. It does not really matter where you place or in which direction you place cables and so on. Of course, where there is light, there's also shadow. So you need to have some basic statistics to interpret your test results. It's kind of difficult to say something about direction and polarization. And also quite different to a semi-anechoic chamber. If you put a large device on a test inside this reverb chamber, it will be coupled with the test environment itself. So a big lossy EUT will lower the quality factor of this chamber, of this resonator, and you need to include this or take into account this for analyzing the results. And because we measure for emission measurements, we measure total radiated power, something completely different than in the classical test environments where you measure maximum field strength in a certain distance, it's a bit challenging to compare your results with the established test environments. So typical setup, this is a sketch from the IEC standard. You have this chamber, you have at least one stirrer, you might have more stirrers, and then you have something which is called the working volume, which is a cuboid, and you would check for the field uniformity at these eight corners of this cuboid. This is where you place your device on a test, and then you typically also have a second room where your amplifiers are and where your other measurement equipment is located. This is, as said, a picture from the standard. So at our university in Magdeburg here, we are quite lucky because we have three of these reverberation chambers. We have a large one. This is the one that I'm sitting in right now. This is also kind of a famous picture. If you check the English Wikipedia for electromagnetic mode stereo chambers, you will find this picture, which is quite popular because of the motorcycle. The motorcycle actually was never tested here. It was the motorcycle of some other colleague, and it was just put into the chamber to make the photo look nice, to be honest. And here you can see this old stirrer design. And greetings back to Chicago. In this old stirrer design, it was a triangle shape, and there were metal plates connected to this triangle shape. And if you look at this old stirrer design, let's say with the view of some low frequency, high, large wavelengths field, then it looks like a strangely shaped cylinder. And if you rotate the cylinder, nothing will really happen. As you can see, the dimensions, it's quite large. First cavity resonance, it's something like 30 megahertz in the lowest usable frequency. With the old stirrer was at around 250 megahertz. Now with the better improved stirrer, we can go down to 200, 180, maybe 150, depending on how exact you wanted to have. And this chamber is this year 25 years old, as you can see. So then we also have a smaller one. The idea of building a smaller one is that if you want to go to high frequencies and want to go to high field strengths, you don't need to have this large chamber. And if you want to do immunity testing, the power or the power density or the energy density inside the large chamber is not super high because you spread your input power to a large volume. If you use a smaller chamber, of course, the lowest usable frequency goes up. So this is something like a little more than 1 cubic meter, lowest usable frequency at 1 gigahertz. But in this small chamber, we can reach more than 1 kilovolts per meter of field strength with a 100-watt amplifier. This is quite a lot. So you can disturb lots of devices and maybe also destroy some of them. And then we have an even smaller reverb chamber that we call tiny one. It's a tabletop device, just something 60 by 60 by 60 centimeters. Not exactly, of course, because this would give you degenerate modes. And there the lowest usable frequency is at around 2 gigahertz. Very simple stereo, just one plate moving around. Strangely shaped antennas that have strange radiation patterns, but you do not care about these radiation patterns. You just care about the insertion or the reflection loss of these antennas, which is very low. And this can be used to test handheld communication devices, for example, for total radiated power. Then if you are interested in some literature, as said, there is this IEC standard, first edition from 20 years ago and a second edition from 2011. And this explains validation and measurements. We will come to this in the second part. There is a nice, I would not call it book, but it's a report from NIST Galen Koepke and John Ledbury and Dennis Kamel, that is very nicely and very understandable written, where they evaluate some chamber that was used for NASA tests, the NASA Langley Center Mode Steric Chamber Facility, how is it called? And there are, of course, other standards. So there is some ISO standard for the automotive world. There is some DO 160 standard for aircraft and aircraft equipment. So if you are interested in this, of course, you can take a look at this. Okay, so let's come to some theoretical fundamentals. And here I have a second task for you. I've prepared a short survey. Let me see if I can... there is the poll. How can I get it into the chat? There's a chat window. So there is this poll in the chat. I will switch back to this. You can also, of course, use your cell phone or smartphone with some QR code scanner to scan this. And to answer this question, what happens if the frequency of the excitation of the field that we put here inside this chamber exactly coincides with some eigenfrequency of the chamber, so that we reach some resonance? And the possible answers is there will be an incredibly high field strength then because you hit the resonance, or this is not possible because you can never exactly match these frequencies, or nothing really spectacular will happen because this is the usual operation of a mode stereo chamber or reverberation chamber. Or in this case, there will be a large reflected power going back from the transmitting antenna to the power amplifier. Okay, so let's see what you have chosen, and I will just check for the results. And interestingly, okay, just 8 people in total voted, and 4 said there will be incredibly high field strength, and the other half said, okay, there will be a large reflected power going back from the transmitting antenna to the power amplifier. And I can tell you, unfortunately, both of these answers are wrong. The right answer is the third one here, nothing spectacular. So if we do measurements here in the reverb chamber and if we insert some field here, we always hit a resonance of this chamber, and we not always hit one resonance of this chamber, we always hit like 5 of them or 10. And we want to do this, so we always want to be in resonance, and we only not want to hit one of these resonances. Okay, and yeah, in this case, typically there is no reflection from, or not so much reflection coming back from the transmitting antenna, because the antenna in this case is quite well matched to the chamber. Because most of the power goes into the chamber and into the field. And yeah, there is a high field strength, but not really incredibly high. It's just the usual field strength that we get in here. Okay, so first thing to start with when looking at the theory is to start with the empty cavity resonator, which I've modeled here as some cuboid with dimensions A, B, and C. And you can then calculate the cavity resonances using this quite well-known formula. You need to have the velocity of light, C0. And then these L, M, and N are integer numbers, and only one of them can be zero. And then if you put different numbers in there, 1, 2, 3, and so on, and one can be zero, you can calculate the resonant frequencies. And here I've used the dimensions, the approximate dimensions here of the chamber that I'm sitting in. And you can see, okay, the first cavity resonance is at around 30 megahertz, as mentioned, for L and M equal to 1. And then we have the second cavity resonance at something like 45 megahertz, 46 or 47, 48, 49. And then they are closer and closer together. So if you would plot the number of resonant frequencies with respect to frequency. So on the x-axis, there's the frequency, and here is this cumulated number of modes or of eigenfrequencies. You would get something like this. So the first one is at 30 and the second one at 45, and then they are closer and closer and closer together, and you then almost get You don't see the single steps here anymore, of course. And then we can see, okay, at around 200 megahertz or 250 megahertz, we already have something like 200, 300, a couple of hundred modes. Or it is not at the same time, but it's already like the 200th, 300th mode inside our reverb chamber. Okay, so then the next important theoretical property of such a cavity resonator is the quality factor, which is the angular frequency of the excitation multiplied with the stored energy divided by the average power loss during one cycle of this oscillation that we have in here. And what limits this quality factor, or what causes losses? You have losses, of course, inside the dielectric here, but it's usually air, so these losses are very small. Then we have losses at the walls. Here they are made out of steel. In a smaller chamber, as you've seen, it's made out of copper or aluminum. These are the typical materials. And then, of course, if you put something in here, this will also load the chamber. And at least at low frequencies, the highest losses will be inside the antennas, because the antennas have a quite large effective area at small frequencies and correspondingly large wavelengths, and cables and your IoT and so on. So this quality factor that we just mentioned now also corresponds to the relative bandwidth, or to the resonant frequency divided by the absolute bandwidth. And so if we have losses, we have a finite quality factor. And if you have a finite quality factor, there will be also some finite excess at some resonance. You do not get infinitely high field strengths or incredibly high field strengths. You just get high field strengths. And you can also excite these modes outside their resonant frequencies, and these modes can overlap. So I've tried to plot this here a little bit. If we are at quite low frequencies for our chamber here, 100 at around 125 megahertz. So these are, and you can see, okay, these the modes, these eigenfrequencies, they are still quite separated with quite some distance. If we assume a quality factor of 1000, then we would say this is some undermoded field. There are not enough modes that we would really have the field that we want to have inside the reverb chamber, because we get a high field strength here, but not so high field strength here, and another high field strength here, and so on. So if we take the same quality factor and now go for higher frequencies, so double the frequency, 250 megahertz, then you can see these modes are now so close together, we have so many of these resonant frequencies very close together, that at one frequency, 250 megahertz, for example, we excite this mode a lot, and this a little bit, and this a little less, and this one, and so on. And if you look at the superposition of all these modes, you almost get a straight line. And these are the conditions that we want to have. This is what is called overmoded field, or overmoding. So then if your quality factor is too high, so now if we would have still the very same frequency, but increase this quality factor by a factor of 10, then you still have the same resonant frequencies, but now their overlap is getting smaller, because their modal bandwidth is getting smaller because of this high quality factor. So now once again, our field is undermoded and not really usable for measurements inside this chamber. So having a too high quality factor is also not wanted or detrimental for the measurements here. Sometimes you also load the chamber to improve the field conditions. Okay, so then the next question is how to steer the field. There are many options. You can have a mechanical steerer that rotates, you can have moving walls, you can move your transmitting antenna around, you could switch between several antennas, or have two or three or four or five antennas and shift the phase between them. And for immunity testing, you could also just do narrow band frequency changes. This would be called frequency steering, and because if you change the frequency a little bit, the field in the reverb chamber will drastically change, but you would not expect that the behavior of your EEG drastically changes if you change the frequency, let's say, from 500 to 501 megahertz, but in the reverb chamber, the due to this small modal bandwidth, field would change. Okay, there are some pictures here of this moving wall chambers. I can also show you such a tent later on here in the lab tour. These are pictures from Frank Levering. There are also chambers with a moving wall, breathing wall stirrer. And because of this, there are lots of terms for reverb chamber that more or less all mean electrical, essentially the same. And in Germany, we call it Modenverwirbelungskammer, which is more or less a literal translation of mode stereo chamber. And some also call it a variable field chamber, something like this. So at the end, this more or less all means the same. So a quick look onto the statistical properties. Field is statistically homogeneous, so it does not matter where we place our device on a test, which is quite nice. And the field is also isotropic, so it does not matter in which direction we have our device on a test and the attached cables. And there is a third property which is not that popular, let's say. This is called ergodicity, and ergodicity means we can interchange statistical ensembles. So if you measure the field for different positions of the stirrer and calculate some average, it would be the same average as if you leave the stirrer in place and measure the field in different positions in space, for example. You can exchange these statistical ensembles. Okay, then let's come to the third section and look at the normative measurements and validation. So what you at first usually do before you start any measurements is if you validate your chamber for field uniformity and for the loading to check if you have these field conditions that you want to have and to determine what is the lowest usable frequency of your chamber. And you do this for the empty chamber and for the maximum loaded chamber, and to simulate loading by a very large EOT, you put some absorbers into the chamber and you measure the empty chamber, you measure this maximum loaded chamber, and then you say, okay, if my EOT does something in between, it will probably be also okay. And then for every EOT that you measure, you should typically also do this EOT validation to at least analyze the loading by this EOT. Of course, if you have a chamber of this size here, a room-sized chamber, and if your EOT is in the size of a mobile device, you do not really need to do this, because such a small device will of course not drastically load such a large chamber. But for a larger EOT, it's a quite good thing to do so. Okay, so then for some radiated immunity tests, you need to define some test field strengths and from this calculate some input power, and the input power that you need will be proportional to the square of the field strengths, of course. And then you feed or insert this certain amount of input power, and the proportionality factor between this field strength and the input power results from this validation that I've just briefly discussed before, from this empty chamber validation and the validation with the EOT in place. And so for some immunity test, typically you want to have a high quality factor, low losses, so you remove all unnecessary absorbing materials. Also wooden tables should not be used, and carpets, of course, but usually you don't have this in such a chamber. And then you use a logarithmic frequency spacing, use the same number of stirrer steps used during the validation. And maybe you need some dwell time for each stirrer step and each frequency to allow your device and test to react onto the field. And that's why having mode steering, so continuous rotation of the stirrer and sweeping of the frequency at the same time, then this gives you a very quick test, but it's not very reliable, because at the end you do not really know what field conditions did you get during such a test. Okay, so then for the emission, the idea is that you put your device on a test somewhere and let it radiate, and you measure with some antenna some average received power. And if you then know the efficiency of this antenna, and if you know a factor that is called chamber validation factor, then you can calculate from this average received power at some antenna, you can calculate the radiated power or total radiated power from some device in our test. And this chamber validation factor you get once again from some validation measurements, where you basically more or less measure what is the coupling between two antennas inside this chamber, and then you assume, okay, from your device and test to the receiving antenna, it will be more or less the same coupling, the same insertion loss, let's say. Okay, so this brings me to a second question. I will just shortly click on this so that I can copy the link into the chat. And there's a link in the chat. And the question for you is, what is difficult to be measured in a reverberation chamber? I've not written that it's not possible or that it's impossible, but what is difficult to be measured? Is it shielding effectiveness of cables, connectors, waveguides, and so on, shielding effectiveness of gaskets and materials, modulated signal measurements for wireless devices? Is it antenna efficiency, or is it antenna directivity?
Antenna directivity.
Yeah, please cast your vote. Ah, okay. Ah, hello, Carl. So let's see if this worked. It was a single choice question. Okay, so 19 votes all voted for antenna directivity. Excellent. And so you can, but it's difficult. It doesn't really make sense. There are better measurement environments to measure antenna directivity, but it's not impossible to do so. Let's say that if you check EMC Europe conferences, for example, there are always some papers who do this. Okay, so then let's come to the last section, some comparison with other test environments. And the first thing that I would like to mention or to discuss is, during some typical immunity test or measurement in a classical anechoic environment, you often define something like some electric field strengths. And in these anechoic environments, your field is more or less some plane wave. So you have some direction of propagation, which is denoted by the C vector here. And you have some electric and magnetic field components, and they are all perpendicular to each other. So you have this transverse electromagnetic field. And now, or you could also call it a linearly polarized plane wave with some amplitude. And this amplitude, E0 or E0, at the same time is the amplitude of the main Cartesian field component. It's also the total electric field strength of this plane wave. And it's also the minimum and average and maximum field strengths. And the minimum and maximum and average squared magnitude of this field is also just this, but squared. And so in an anechoic environment, if you say, okay, I have a field of, let's say, 100 volts per meter, then you know, okay, total field strength, minimum, maximum, average, Cartesian component, total field, everything will be 100 volts per meter, and the square will be the square of this. And this is not the case for some reverberating field. So if you would insert some field here and measure, you would find out, okay, the Cartesian field component is different from the total field, and the average is different from the maximum and the minimum, and so on and so on. So it's much more difficult to define this, what is meant by some electric field. So this is one issue for the immunity test, but with some statistical theory in the background, you can somehow deal with this. Okay, so then if we take a look at emission measurements, something interesting, and this also deals with the measurements in the semi-anechoic in the anechoic environment and semi-anechoic environment is we need to discuss what is the electrical size of our equipment under test of our EUT. And the usual definition is it's the wave number multiplied with the radius of the smallest sphere that would encircle or surround the EUT. And wave number depends on frequency and velocity of light or propagation, or is 2 pi over the wavelength. And okay, this radius somehow depends on the size of the EUT. And when defining the size, of course, there is a question, what belongs to the EUT? Is it just the EUT itself? Are these cables attached? And which line lengths of cables and so on has to be considered? But let's say we have a well-defined EUT and we could put this circle around and have some radius. So then, if this Ka, this electrical size, is smaller, much smaller than 1, we would call it an electrically small EUT. And no matter how complex it is, as long as it's small compared to the wavelengths, the radiation pattern will look like the radiation pattern of a dipole. And the radiation pattern of a dipole is this donut shape. If the EUT has a strange shape, then the donut will be somehow misformed, but it will be more or less this donut. And what's easy with this donut, it's easy to find the direction of maximum emission, because if you rotate the donut, at least in steps of 90 degrees, you will always find a maximum with a quite good or quite high probability. So now if this Ka gets larger than 1 and much larger than 1, we have electrically large EUTs and they get strange radiation patterns. And there's a nice video and measurement data that has been produced by Magnus Sawyer of FOI of Sweden. And hopefully there is now a video, and the video plays. And as you can see here, the frequency goes up. Now we are at around 1 gigahertz, and you can see how the radiation pattern of this device in a test, as far as I remember, it's something like the size of half a meter, how this changes, and that it gets, that the lobes get narrower and narrower, and that it's getting more and more difficult to find the maximum emitted field strength. Because if you would measure in 90 degree directions, let's say here and here and here and here, you would see, okay, I always measure a minimum, and this maximum moves around, and it's quite difficult to predict what will be the direction of this maximum emission, because now it's changing from here to there, and now it's changing to here. And you would really need to rotate your device and test in very, very small steps, or move the antenna in small angle steps around your device and test to get this maximum emission in an anechoic environment. So that's some issue. Okay, so now looking at this transition from electrically small to electrically large devices, this is a table from Perry Wilson, also from NIST. So you can see here the frequency and the corresponding wave number, and k times a, the electrical size, is always 1. So this is the border, the transition between electrically small and electrically large. And here you can see the corresponding radius or diameter of your device under test. So at 30 megahertz, everything will be electrically small, no problem. If you go to 1 gigahertz, for example, things that are larger than 10 centimeters in diameter, they will already be electrically large, and it will be more and more challenging to measure this maximum emission in some anechoic, semi-anechoic environment. And above 10 gigahertz, or at 10 gigahertz, you can see the diameter. If something is larger than 1 centimeter, so everything, almost everything, virtually everything, is electrically large then. And there's a second very interesting table. So here, the object, the EUT, has a diameter of 50 centimeter. And in this table, corresponding to the different frequencies, how many orientations you would need to measure to really get the maximum field strength, the maximum emitted field strength in a certain direction or into the direction of the maximum. And as you can see, for small frequencies, 200 megahertz, even 500 megahertz, you do not need so many orientations, but if you go up to 10 gigahertz, due to this pencil-like radiation patterns, very sharp, very thin, small lobes, you need lots of orientations, and you cannot measure this in an anechoic environment, same anechoic chamber, fully anechoic room. You will always undersample. And now, so if we compare the anechoic environment, what is nice there, your environment is somehow deterministic. You know your environment very well, but you don't know nothing about your EOT. Your EOT is random. No one knows the radiation pattern of its EOT. So at large frequencies, at high frequencies for electrically large EOTs, you get a huge uncertainty in these emission measurements due to the randomness of the radiation pattern of your EOT. And in the reverberation chamber, the environment is random, but okay, we can nicely describe this randomness by the statistical field theory. But the good thing is our EOT is totally deterministic. It does not matter what the radiation pattern of our EOT is here inside the reverb chamber. We will always measure this total radiated power with a very good accuracy and precision, let's say. And the accuracy and precision statistical uncertainty just depends on how many independent boundary conditions, stereo positions we have here inside the field. So final thing that I would like to show you, some measurement results of my former colleague, Matthias Hürte. He has used a very large radiator, so a metallic box with some comp generator in there with some loop antennas, measured it in the reverb chamber here, measured it in the semi-anechoic chamber, and then compared the results. So this is field strength in dB volts or microvolts per meter with respect to frequency, and the blue curve is the measurement that you get, or the result that you get, the maximum field strength that you get in the anechoic, semi-anechoic chamber, and the green curve is the maximum that you get from the measurement in the reverberation chamber using a directivity of 1. So the difference between the two curves is more or less the directivity of the device under test, and including the uncertainty of, I think this was measured with 1 or 2 degree steps in the semi-anechoic chamber. And so what he has also analyzed is what happens if you undersample in the semi-anechoic chamber. So if you measure just with 90 degree steps, maybe as usual, and if you do finer stepping like 10 degree steps. And then you can see for low frequencies, there's no huge difference, but for higher frequencies, there can be something like 5 dB between these curves, because you do not find really the direction of maximum emission, this small beam with small lobe of some EOT in the classical anechoic environment. Okay, so if we do some final comparison, in the semi-anechoic chamber, you have a plane wave field, you have linear polarization. If you know your field at one position, the correlation length is quite long, so you also know the field at different positions, you know the incident direction, and your field has a well-defined field impedance, this 377 ohm as the ratio between the electric and magnetic field component. In the reverb chamber, we have lots of reflections. We don't know anything about the polarization of our field. The field has also a very short correlation length, something like half a wavelength. So if you know the field at one position, you don't know anything about field at some adjacent position. It can be high, it can be small, it can be something in between. Your field virtually comes from all directions at the same time, and the field impedance, you know the average or you know the median, but at one position you can have a high impedance field, a low impedance field. No one really knows. And final slide, every environment has its pros and cons, as you can see with Semi-anechoic chambers, you can also measure quite large EUTs. The GTEM has the advantage you can already measure starting from very low frequencies, and in the reverb chamber, you always have a problem at low frequencies, but it's at high frequencies you have these very good and very uniform and very reproducible fields, and your test time and uncertainty stays constant, more or less no matter how high you go in frequency. So the more fundamental question is, what is a good measurement for emission? Is it really field strength in a certain distance, or power flux density, or is it maybe more total radiated power independent of the distance? And is what we replicate in our semi-anechoic environment a totally reflection-free environment? Is this really what we have in practice? Because if you look at typical, at least industrial facilities, there's lots of metal around and there will be lots of reflections, maybe not as highly reflective as in a reverb chamber, but much more reflections as in a semi-anechoic environment. And so coming back to the question from the beginning from Carl Baum, this is also a picture from this microwave memo. And so here you can see the chicken and you can see the lossless modes there, and you can see power coming into this chamber. And so then he writes down a power balance and say, okay, the power input into the chamber must need to go into the walls. We have losses in the walls and we have losses in the stirrer, and we have, of course, losses inside our chicken. But in a good chamber, in a high quality factor chamber, we can assume, okay, the losses in the walls, they are very small, they are zero. The losses in the stirrer, they are also very small or close to zero. So the input power, everything goes into the chicken, and this is also the conclusion from this paper. All power to the chicken. This concludes my talk. Thanks for your attendance. And now, of course, I would be happy to answer some questions and maybe also do some short lab tour if you like.